Okay, I think we're all good to go. 7 o'clock, we're gonna start our question and answer segment here for any viewers that have any questions about the severe weather tonight. Of course, it is a Weather Authority Alert Day due to the threat for damaging winds and the possibility of isolated tornadoes as we head into the overnight hours. Just that concern itself that many people may be headed to bed early just because it's a school day tomorrow, what the threats are tonight and what you need to do to prepare for this event.
Kind of just looking over the very latest run of our RPM model. That's the in-house model we use for the hour-by-hour forecast that you see whenever we are on Local 6. And looks like right now kind of narrowing down between maybe 9 p.m. for those storms to enter into southeast Missouri, at least into our counties. I'm talking about Poplar Bluff up through Fredericktown. Moving on to the east, looks like the primary line probably getting into the Penny Royal Parkway area around 2, 3 o'clock in the morning right now. So that 5-6 hour window is really the time frame that we're most concerned about tonight.
And we're going to repeat here too, broadcast was off and on there for a second, but to remind all of you, it is Weather Authority Alert Day, mainly for the overnight hours tonight, essentially now until the overnight hours tonight, as you were talking about some of the timing. Our major threats are damaging winds as well as isolated tornadoes that I think especially will be across Missouri and Tennessee, possibly into western Kentucky as we go through the next several hours. Storms are still off to our west. The main energy from this storm is also just to our west, but starting to get cranking now as we move into the next hour or two.
Yeah, and if you see me glance down, I'm actually trying to take a look at some radar data and stuff on my phone, so bear with me on that. But we are kind of starting to see some scattered shower activity over southern Illinois and southeast Missouri. Initially, none of that is severe right now. No. All the forcing, the front, still well off toward our west. But certainly seeing some warnings across sections of Arkansas tonight. It looks like, in fact, a couple of tornado warnings now in Arkansas.
Not surprising. That line that was coming through from West Plains back down to I-40 was looking pretty strong, and I'd assume that's probably where those warnings are on, right?
The tornado warning is actually, if you're familiar with that area at all, it's off to the west of Hot Springs. So we're talking western Arkansas, mm-hmm. out near Mount Ida. But there are some severe thunderstorm warnings associated with that line. A little closer to our area, it does look like, off to the north of I-40, actually in really closer to the Ozarks, off to the west of Mountain View. So some pretty rural areas out there, but it is at least getting closer to the Arkansas-Missouri line, and that would eventually bring it out toward West Plains, Missouri, maybe within the next hour or so.
We've already got one question from Rob at the Planetarium off Twitter. He's asking about how long after signing up for weather call does it take effect. And Rob, I got your message earlier, and I've put out an email to our provider to make sure that they know we've got people possibly signing up tonight. And normally what they have told us in the past is as soon as you sign up, you're instantly ready to go for warnings for the overnight hours. So you should be good to go if you've signed up for that. We're going to talk about weather call for just a second. There are several different ways weather call works. If you get weather call home, that will call a landline or a cell phone number, but it's tied to your home address, whatever address you want to be alerted for. So then there's also weather call mobile, which is for your phone, which you can then GPS. You have to have a smartphone with GPS enabled. It'll travel with you. And weather call is very unique in that it will only warn you if you're in the polygon warning, not the entire county,
right.
But if you're in the polygon warning of that storm, the immediate danger part, then you're going to be alerted by that storm.
Yeah. And I think what cost on weather calls is
$9.95,
$10 bucks for the year, for a yearly subscription.
And that's for at the home. And I think it's maybe $14.95.
I believe it's a little bit more for
the
mobile.
Cell phone.
Yeah.
But definitely worth it if you don't have a weather radio. Or if you want a second source for warnings, that is definitely the way to go. Let's talk about timing just one more time,
okay.
because I think that's important to most people. Right now, as you said, we've got just some isolated, some scattered showers across southern Illinois and southeast Missouri, non-severe at this time. We're still kind of waiting for the energy to move out of southern Arkansas and up through our area, and that's why we're still waiting until probably closer to 9, 10 o'clock before things really get going.
Yeah, I was taking a look at the RPM forecast model. That's the one we use to put together our hour-by-hour forecast that we show graphically here on Local 6, and it really brought the main line, the main energy into our westernmost counties in southeast Missouri at around 9 o'clock tonight. So we're talking about places like Fredericktown, Greenville, Poplar Bluff, and then it scoots it on toward the Mississippi River by around 11 o'clock on into right at the heart of the area. We're talking about along and east of I-57 in southern Illinois and then down into the Purchase area of Kentucky, West Tennessee. We'll say in between 11 p.m. and 1 a.m., kind of in that. We like to give a little bit of a window there in case this thing speeds up a little bit or slows down. But really, west to east across their area, about really 9 p.m. to about 3 in the morning is really the bullseye as far as the time frame for us.
And just a reminder, the Storm Prediction Center has continued to keep us in this moderate risk for severe weather. And their main concern, and I stress this just because it's already windy outside, we've got high wind gusts, the potential for widespread wind damage is very high, and so that's why they have us in the moderate risk. We still have that heightened risk for isolated tornadoes, but you'll notice, obviously, tonight winds have picked up quite a bit. The low-level winds are very strong, and when you get those big towering thunderstorms like we're seeing off to the west, a lot of times they tap into the mid and upper-level winds, and they drag them down to the surface and enhance an already strong wind field at the surface, and that can produce damage very easily.
And we're talking about winds at, 5,000-10,000 feet that are racing along, 80, 90, 100 miles per hour. And so it doesn't take a whole lot for some of that rain, some of that energy to drag those winds down to the surface. One of the interesting things, this is going back to a couple of questions that I had on Facebook earlier today, just on my own personal page, I had posted a couple of the Storm Prediction Center, their outlooks that talk specifically about tornado risk and about the wind risk and the wind risk for our area. There is a 45%, well, they were asking, what does that 45% mean? That simply the Storm Prediction Center, they give have given our area a 45% probability of seeing severe level winds, which are classified at 58 miles per hour or greater. They've given us a 45% chance of seeing that within 25 miles of any given point. So that's kind of the technical side of that. Bottom line, that's a pretty high percentage.
Yeah, it doesn't sound high, but that is about as high as I've seen. I've seen a little bit higher in a high-risk situation, but when it comes to winds, that's a pretty high indicator that we're anticipating those storms produce damaging winds. Now, the tornado threat is at 15%, last I checked.
Yes, especially for the Boot Hill, Missouri, and Northwest Tennessee.
Yeah, and from looking at some of the dynamics, we've been looking at some of the updating products from the Storm Prediction Center, is most of that energy right now is down to the south.
Right.
Now, we're included in the moderate risk because we anticipate that energy moving up through our area at some point tonight. Whether we can keep any instability or not, that'll be the key to whether there's any tornado development, which, again, winds are our primary concern. We've got another viewer asking what time for Paducah, and we'll go over this a couple of times. We're now watching the main line in Missouri coming out of the Ozarks and pushing into southeast Missouri. We anticipate that around 8 or 9 o'clock to make its way into southeast Missouri. Then we're talking about probably 10 to midnight getting close to the Ohio River, the Paducah area. So very well maybe at Local 6 at 10, we could be covering severe weather at that point along the Ohio River, which does include Paducah. And then eventually this line starts to really, it looks like it's going to chug along pretty fast into the Pennyroyal region, the lakes down through Tennessee by 1 o'clock. And we may see a couple rounds of storms with this. We just kind of have to wait and see how it unfolds over our areas. That energy works its way out of the Mid-South later tonight.
Yeah. In case you missed it earlier in the newscast, if we have anybody that wasn't watching, Local 6 at 6, you did an interesting story with Robert Bradfield.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the reasons that we really hit these nighttime events hard is because of our history in our area. Of course, we have had a number of occurrences over the last 10, 15 years of storms that hit when you just don't think about storms hitting. It's January, most people are thinking, when's it going to snow again? When's it going to get cold? And your mind is just not on severe weather. But here's some interesting numbers.
That and nighttime.
Yeah.
That's the other big thing.
Right.
Is you know, normally you think the heat of the day, that's when you're going to see your big storms.
Yeah.
And we do. But in the wintertime, typically these systems come in at night and they don't lose steam. So.
Yeah. Here's some interesting numbers for you. Based on recent research in southeast Missouri, southern Illinois, western Kentucky, 43 of the 52 tornado deaths since 1996 have occurred at night. 36 of those 52 have occurred between midnight and sunrise. 37 of those 52 were in mobile homes. And so those are the things that we always harp on.
Right.
If it's at night, you got to have a way to get the warning. And if you are in a mobile home, you have to have a more substantial place of shelter.
This is it right here.
Yeah.
You know, we talk about weather call. That's great, too, especially those of you that have landlines. That's a great way to get warnings at night. But also, you know, double arm yourself. We like to talk about having an arsenal of products that can alert you if if one fails. We saw that, you said Evansville, earlier today, Memphis had a complete outage of all of their transmitters for their weather radio. And so for a while, we were concerned that no one was going to get weather radio alerts tonight. That problem has been resolved from what I hear.
Yes. Yeah.
But, you know, this is a Midland weather radio. We promote these basically because they give our viewers a discount if you purchase them through the website or local Walgreens carries them. And it's, you know, you can get a basic model for $29.99 up to this model, which is closer to $60. But they all give you the warning that you need.
Yeah. Yeah. And the good thing about these, too, is that they're programmable for your county. You can go in, you can just program in your county, or you can, what we recommend a lot of times is to program the counties that surround you, at least the counties to your northwest and to your south. It's fairly easy to do that. We actually have, if you go to WPSDlocal6.com, under the weather tab, under inside the storm, we actually have the county codes there for you. You can download that information and look that up. But yeah, these are great. They're not 100% foolproof. And so it's always good to have a second source to get those warnings. There are a ton of apps on smartphones that will help you out with that. And, of course, Weather Call through WPSD Local 6 and our Local 6 mobile alerts, which you can also sign up for at WPSDlocal6.com. Those are very, very helpful as well.
Just looking here, they still, we were talking about the Storm Prediction Center is watching our area for possible watch. Is that...
issue
just come out? What time does that go until?
1.
That runs until 1 o'clock. Does that cover the rest of the area?
No. Illinois, parts of West Kentucky.
Okay, so it looks like they're going to fill in from southern Illinois down through western Kentucky, the new
Thanks.
Tornado watch.
Yeah, tornado watch to 1 a.m. and it includes, we'll go ahead and say all of southern Illinois. The
rest of southeast Missouri.
Yeah, the rest of southeast Missouri and Kentucky right now.
Purchase area.
Yeah, Ballard, Carlisle, Fulton, Hickman, Graves, and McCracken. So
it's the purchase area. So everyone east of the lakes is basically out of this for now. That may change later, but the rest of the local six area. Now, I don't think northwest Tennessee is in it, right, that we know of? Northwest Tennessee has not been added yet, but the Boot Hill of Missouri is already in a tornado watch until 1 a.m. So... that's the very latest just coming down from the Storm Prediction Center. But again, yeah, we talked about the weather radio and how vital that is. I'll give an example that I did yesterday that we were talking about the storm that came through that hit Livingston County. We had tornado warnings from McCracken County as well. Well, you know, I was sick in bed. I didn't have the TV on. I didn't have anything on. And I got a weather call to my phone saying that I was in the path of a tornado warning, and that's when I immediately was able to turn on and see the coverage and actually get to the closet, because it got a little hairy at my place, got real windy, kind of scary, so I got into the closet, what I'm supposed to do, and you know, alerting me when I, you know, I knew it was raining, I knew we had a severe weather threat, but you know, these storms can pop up very quickly, and it got me to a safe place. It just could have been a tornado.
Yeah.
You know, it ended up producing a tornado, just not where I was. So that was the good thing about having weather call even for myself.
And there's countless stories like that. We've been running a promo here recently about the lady there with the Livingston County storm that received our Local 6 mobile alert. And she was actually supposed to be in the church that collapsed at that point in time. She got the alert. She was able to stay at home and take cover and thankfully was safe.
I think we have another question
here.
Rob on Twitter asking again, are the portable weather radios as good as the base units? And I say yes, as long as they have the same coating on them. Some of them don't, and that's fine if you just want something that will go off for anything. But the handheld that Walgreens carries as well can be programmed for your home, and then you can travel. Then you can switch it to a travel mode and take it with you anywhere you want.
Yeah.
So those are just as good. You can use them at home or on the go. Just depends on your preference. There's a lot of people that don't travel and that just kind of homebound, and all they need is the desktop model. Or if you do a lot of traveling, the other one's probably good for you too.
Let's see. Checking Facebook to see if we have any new questions coming in. Had a couple of questions asking about Northwest Tennessee and what's going to be going on there. And really, Northwest Tennessee's in the same ballgame as the rest of us. We're talking about the threat for severe weather. Later on down the line, I say for Tennessee, we can throw them into maybe the 9, 10 to about 2 in the morning time frame.
Yeah.
Until we really get that energy coming in out of Arkansas, we're kind of still waiting on that to see exactly how fast these storms are going. But one of the things we talked about earlier this afternoon is that another aspect of these wintertime events is because the jet stream energy is so dynamic, these storms really, really race along. And tonight, I'm guessing that storms will be probably moving at about 50, 60 miles per hour. And so you're just not going to have a ton of reaction time with these storms. That's why if you wait until you hear the storm outside your window, obviously it's too late. So you got to have a way to get that warning ahead of time.
Looks like Jeff Wolgus has a question for us. He wants to know, what do we think about the storm mode, discrete cells or linear? And I think we've got both at play. A lot of it's going to be linear, I think, but we'll have embedded supercells within the line like we saw earlier in the St. Louis area. I think once this energy starts popping out of Arkansas, they're already getting the tornado warning in the Little Rock area. I think that's what we're starting to see unfold is we'll start to see some isolated cells out ahead of the line. And I think that would be at most risk for Northwest Tennessee. I think that's where your greater tornado threat is going to be with those isolated storms out ahead of the line. But a lot of this looks like it's racing so fast to the east. I don't know how much is going to be able to pop up ahead of it before the line gets
I think linear is a slam dunk in the equation tonight. Discrete, you know, certainly possible, but reading a couple things from the SPC earlier, they're talking about a warm layer at about the 850 millibar level, which we're talking about roughly 1,500, 2,000 feet. That's kind of helping to keep the instability a little bit lower. The problem is our low-level jet's going to start kicking in, and then we're really going to get that surge of the moisture coming in. And so it's kind of going to negate the instability portion of it. So I think as that low-level jet kicks in, you know, that's where we're really going to see the line ramping up and moving across the area. But I think our big tornado problem, if we have a tornado tonight, most likely it's going to be one of those embedded tornadoes within our line.
Yeah. That was the case, and this leads to the next question here from Simone Parker, 39, wanting to know how rare are these storms for this time of the year. Well, you know, we had a line of storms that came in. This is the night of Evansville, worked that night, and it just happened to be embedded in the line. You had one storm that produced an EF3 in Crittenden County.
Yeah.
We had some injuries there that same night, but then went on to kill 26, I believe, in the Evansville area. The big problem in Evansville was the transmitter, the weather radio transmitter, was down.
Right.
Not that that's the way to alert people in the middle of the night, but that was down, and so weather radios weren't going on. The outdoor sirens were not going off, and you just have an unfortunate situation where at 2 a.m. in the morning, everyone's asleep in a mobile home park.
Exactly. It struck a mobile home park, and so you're talking about some very poor structures as far as withstanding a tornado.
And honestly, it's not that rare for this time
it
of
really
year.
Is this is at least a once a winter thing anywhere
yes.
around here.
We typically talk about Tornado Alley being like Texas, Oklahoma. Well, most people I think are starting to realize there is a secondary area called Dixie Alley, which is the deep south, and we kind of hit that northern perimeter of Dixie Alley, especially Tennessee and Kentucky, and down through the Boot Hill of Missouri. And last year, January 22nd, we had two tornadoes touch down in western Kentucky. We had last year in February, the Leap Day storms, an EF4 touch down in Harrisburg up to Ridgeway.
Yeah.
And of course, Evansville was also a November
event. Yeah, we had Evansville. We had the Marshall County tornado in the November 15th, 2005, the outbreak. We had the Marshall County, Earlington, and Paris, Tennessee,
right.
all with EF3 or EF4 tornadoes. We had the Super Tuesday outbreak in 2008, which a lot of the local 6 area missed out on the absolute worst of that. But Jackson, Tennessee was hit by an EF4 tornado. Central City over in Muhlenberg County suffered a very strong tornado. And so this is not anything that's new. January of 2000, Owensboro was hit with an EF3 tornado. And so it's just,
we can't let our guard down at any time of the year.
If there was a winter Tornado Alley, it would be here.
Yeah, and that's, the name of this stream here is Breeding Extreme Weather and Climate. And I kind of chose that name because I feel like it encompasses what this region is weather-wise. We tend to breed just crazy weather all the time, whether it be drought, flooding, tornadoes. I mean, tropical weather impacts our life here. And so that's why we're really focusing on that. But we got a couple more questions here. Craig wants to know, do you keep communication with other forecast areas? Are they useful to you? And yes, we rely heavily on Memphis because they cover our Tennessee counties and Pemiscot-Dunklin County in the Boot Hill of Missouri. Of course, we work very closely with Paducah because we're right here and they cover a majority of our area, but also St. Louis covers one or two of our counties, but they also give us an idea of what's coming.
Right. And one of the key things, one of the most important tools in our toolbox is the National Weather Service chat line. And anytime there is a watch warning issued or even a discussion from the Storm Prediction Center, we get an immediate feed of that. We get that's basically for media and emergency managers, as well as a few other folks that are in on that. And so anytime there's any kind of damage report, we immediately get that information from the National Weather Service, which allows us to really stay on top of things. And that's a very, very useful tool for us.
We have another question too. Weather spotters who don't have wind gauges, what is a good way for us to judge the wind speed so they can report it? Well, what I suggest is you really have to have an anemometer.
Yeah.
If not an anemometer, I know on the Weather Service site somewhere, and I wish I had the link to send you immediately, but if you go to the National Weather Service website, if you click on wind speed or severe weather and wind speed, I think there is some kind of breakdown as to like leaves rustling is like 5 miles per hour, and then just how strong you can kind of gauge, but it's really necessary for spotters to have an anemometer, and you can kind of get a cheap version that just has the minimum for wind speed and temperature at a fairly low price.
Yeah.
But I would encourage any spotter, true spotter out there that is passionate about it, to go ahead and get one.
I think if you want to get weather geeky about it, I think is it the Beaufort scale? Is that right? Yeah. Look that up, and it's got some kind of a category guideline type thing for you, more of a descriptive way to describe the winds that you're seeing. But you really need that anemometer to keep track of things there.
And okay, real quick, we've got Illinois Storm Man is saying he's in Anna, Illinois, and they just saw a flash of lightning while looking to the west. Not surprising there. I could see off to the side here, our radar, there is a little batch of showers and thunderstorms, non-severe, that's just north of Cape Girardeau along the Mississippi River, so that's probably what you're seeing. That's moving off to your north towards Murfreesboro and probably even north of Carbondale, but that's not part of the main line. But we are starting to see more activity pick up here. Another question, do you suggest those who live in structures like mobile homes evacuate now and sleep somewhere else tonight? And absolutely.
Yeah.
We encourage people before the storms to have a plan. And that's exactly why we do suggest that you prepare ahead of time so that if you do live in a mobile home, a manufactured home, it only takes an EF0, EF1, to flip or disintegrate one of those homes. And so finding a place to sleep, whether it's a relative, a neighbor, someone close by that you feel like you're safe in their home,
right,
is the best way to go there.
Yeah, I'm not sure. If you're just, I'm going to pull out my numbers again. For the National Weather Service Paducah forecast area, since 1996, there's been 52 tornado fatalities. 37 of those 52 were in mobile homes. So that gives you an idea of why we preach that you can't be in a mobile home. You gotta have a plan before the storm arrives to go, whether it's a relative, friend, whatever. You gotta get out of that place.
You have to remember too, not only can it flip or disintegrate, but we had the one unfortunate case in Marshall County where the mobile home flipped, which he may have survived in, but it caught on fire. Mm-hmm. And you've got to think of those things too, that you've got gas and electric and all that stuff.
Right.
And that all has to be factored into your plan as well. Otherwise, you know, we talked about it earlier. It's hard to say go lay in a ditch somewhere, because that'd be really hard for me to do, I think.
Yeah.
But honestly, I've seen enough mobile homes and the condition they're in after a tornado mm-hmm. to say, yeah, I'd probably go lie in a ditch if that's my last resort.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
If you're stuck and that's your last resort, you know, take a blanket. Mm-hmm. Heavy blanket so you can cover your head and try and find a low area, a culvert, something like that.
Blanket,
helmet.
Yeah. Bike helmet, baseball, football helmet. I know it may sound silly talking about it, but it really is. And that's another one of those things that's been documented that folks have done that and that probably saved their life because of the situation they're in. So, you know, extreme situations sometimes call for extreme measures. And so, if you're in a mobile home, you're caught off guard, and the best thing to do, get to a ditch, get as low as you can. The farther underground level you can put yourself, the less likely you are to be struck by some sort of flying debris.
We got another question here. Is there a reason that severe weather occurs mostly after dark for our region? And in the wintertime especially, it's because we haven't hit daylight savings yet.
Yeah, there's not as much daylight.
So we get dark at 5:30, 6 o'clock, and, you know, storms roll in after that, and you just can't see them. Whereas in the summertime, most of our storm systems are driven by
Well, this is not good.
All right, well, let me finish this real quick. Not to scare anyone, nope. But talking about the wintertime, a lot of these systems are driven by wind and upper-level winds, and so they tend not to weaken as they push across the area, whereas in the summertime, everything is driven by the heat of the day, and we typically see those more in the late afternoon into the early evening, and plus we've got more daylight in the summertime. So that's why we stress the importance of weather radio during the wintertime, because they usually do come during the dark hours.
Yeah. Speaking of weather radio, this is an update on our situation we were talking about earlier from Memphis. They are still experiencing difficulties. They say that the systems are online, the weather radios in Memphis. However, they're not operating at an optimal level. There's a hum that technicians are aware of. However, it could impact some of the tones in areas that are not in close proximity to a transmitter. And so the list of some of the transmitters there looks like these are...
That's all from Arkansas.
Yeah, these are all from Arkansas. But if you're watching from the Boot Heel of Missouri or Extreme West Tennessee, it looks like Channel 4 on your weather radio comes out of Clay County, Arkansas, which I know is fairly close to your area.
Yeah.
Craighead County in Arkansas is fairly close to the Mississippi River. Green County, so try either Channel 1 or Channel 4 on your weather radio if you happen to be watching from the Boot Heel in Northwest Tennessee.
And but for that, you know, if you're watching from another area, you're not part of our viewing area, but
yeah.
Surrounding viewing area, your local stations or the weather service also has alerts that you can get on your phone. You can get mobile apps that will that will alert you in the middle of the night on your phone. Just make sure it's not on vibrate or you want it to be on. Have a secondary source if you do live in those areas. And of course, the best thing to do is go right now. If you live in Northwest Tennessee, check your weather radio, turn it on, so and see if you can hear the frequency, number one, and you should be good to go. If you hear a hum, I guess that's okay is what they're saying. It's just the outlying areas that sometimes have static problems within hearing it might have some issues tonight. And if you're hearing that static problem or not hearing your frequency very well, then maybe you need to sign up for some mobile alerts as well.
Looks like we got another question from Rob. He asks, are the live feeds for Doppler available over the internet or just go to WPSD?
I want to say, are you talking about the dual pole? Rob, if you can answer that real quick, are you talking about the dual pole radar? If that's the case, it's not available through the weather service.
Yeah, the dual pole products, we had a story about this not too long ago talking about the upgrade, and it is going to be a very helpful upgrade to folks that have a deep knowledge of radar technology. Some of the products, it's not a thing where it's easily interpreted.
The general public probably will not understand the output. It doesn't look like a normal radar image of storms coming in.
You're not going to see greens, yellows, and oranges. You're going to see some other colors and other products. At some point in time, those products may be incorporated into our graphic system or put online through the National Weather Service after a period of training, learning about it, experimenting with it, figuring out a way to make it more understandable to the public. But right now, if you want to get into the dual pole products, you have to download an app. I know I have one, RadarScope, on the iPhone is a very handy radar app. Costs, I believe it's $10, but if you do want to look at that, that's available to you.
Yeah, I recently downloaded it too once Paducah went dual polarization, just because, you know, an event like tonight, it might be very helpful for us. It will actually show us the difference between rain and what might be debris within a tornado signature. So, we'll be looking at that sort of stuff, and it'll help us alert you to pending dangers that may be later on tonight. But it's not generally offered to the public. But if you have a smartphone, you want to go to RadarScope and look at that kind of thing, you can.
Yeah, you can check it out, and obviously you can read more about it, Google it, and some of the different products that are offered, you can learn more about it. I know one of the really cool things I'm excited about with it is there's a product called Correlation Coefficient. Not to get too technical with it, but essentially what it does is it looks at all of the particles that the radar is scanning to see how they are, if they're comparable, if they're similar sizes, similar shapes, stuff like that. If there is one particular area where all of a sudden you see a different kind of particle, that kind of lets us know, hey, this may be tornadic debris, something like that, and it will very clearly show up there, which helps to confirm to us what we're seeing through through other radar products.
We've got a question from Live4My3. Compared to past storms, are these looking more severe? Well, right now, as we're kind of watching off the screen, there are tornado warnings for the Little Rock area. Looks like a pretty impressive storm there. That's basically the energy that we're waiting for to get to our area to see how storms develop here. We expect within the next hour or so, between 8 and 9 o'clock, for us to get a better picture of exactly what kind of storms we're going to be dealing with. But right now, we're keeping an eye on things. That's what we do. We watch out to the west to see how things start to evolve as storms develop, and then watch them move into our area and see how they behave as new energy works its way into the region.
Yeah, and one of the things, this is something we actually talked about yesterday. I read an interesting blog from a colleague down in Alabama not too long ago. James Spann, I don't know, some of you may be familiar with him, but I think he had some viewers that were asking him a similar question. For them, in central Alabama, April 27th, 2011 is kind of their landmark generational tornado outbreak, and so every time there's severe weather, people will say, is this going to be like April 27th? Well, for that particular outbreak, no, probably not, because that's a once-in-a-lifetime deal for most of us. However, to say, is this going to be like, maybe for us, we might say the Leap Day tornado outbreak? Well, for the entire area, it may not be. But if you're one of the five people that are affected by an isolated tornado in the middle of a rural area, then for you it is your landmark outbreak. And so the idea here is that anytime there's a threat for severe weather, we want to let you know about it. That way you can be aware and be ready to go in case you do come under a warning.
I would say this kind of event we've seen before is very similar to January last year, the January 22nd, but also a little similar to the night at the Evansville, where we've got these lines and then there's these embedded supercells within the line. And the two big things about that is, one, you were talking about the movement. It's going to be very fast.
Yeah.
Not going to have much time to get to shelter if you were, in fact, in the path of one of these dangerous storms. And number two, it's nighttime. They're going to be rain-wrapped. So even if you're trying to get a glimpse with lightning and that, you're probably not going to see them because there is a lot of moisture involved with these storms as well. And I'm looking at the radar right now, and storms are getting much closer into southeast Missouri, approaching what looks like Iron County and up towards Farmington and back down towards maybe Donovan. Maybe.
Yeah, it looks like maybe from Farmington, Wapello,
West Plains, definitely.
Yeah.
So it's not going to be too long before we start to see some possible warnings into southeast Missouri.
Closest warning to our area right now is down in just to the north of Little Rock, getting up into the Ozarks in northwest Tennessee, or northern Arkansas. Sorry.
So just a reminder, too, the new Tornado Watch has come out for the Purchase area of western Kentucky, almost all of southern Illinois, and has now included the rest of southeast Missouri, including the Boot Hill, Dunklin, and Pemiscot County. Those go until 1 a.m. The Storm Prediction Center does feel that we're going to be seeing that threat all the way through about 1 a.m., and that's pretty much our thinking, too, is that past 1 a.m., probably talking more about the lakes and eastward.
Yeah, I think so.
Someone asks here, we've got Brent Elkins. He's joined us.
All right.
Hi,
hey, Brent.
How great is the potential for large hail with this system? It's marginal, and what I mean by that is we may see a few with some large hail, especially if we get some isolated supercells, more discrete cells out there. Hail is not the big concern tonight. It's definitely the destructive wind threat.
Yeah, but with hail, I mean, anytime you have severe weather, you can't write it off, but I wouldn't lose any sleep about the hail threat tonight. It's definitely the damaging wind.
We say that, then there will be the one storm.
Yeah, sure. That's usually how it works. Well, but the idea here is that these storms are, they're not going to be your 50,000-foot supercells where you have the optimal environment for hail. These are going to be racing along. Because of the highly sheared environment, they're probably going to be tilted a little bit. And hail, possible, probably not likely.
You got another question here. This is a good one. What are the expected winds with these storms? Heard could be up to 80 miles per hour. And that's easily could see 80 mile per hour winds with some of these storms. Now, outside of the storms, we are actually under a wind advisory for strong winds outside of any thunderstorms. And what we're going to see is as these lines of storms come in, a lot of times what happens is you start getting your feed of winds from the backside of the line. And once they get into the mid-levels, rain, cooling, what have you, will drag those winds down to the surface and create straight-line winds, which can be just as destructive as a weak tornado. And that's probably where you're hearing the 80-mile-per-hour winds. That's, a weak tornado.
Yeah. You're not going to have 80-mile-per-hour winds along the entire length of the line.
No.
But within that line, you're going to see, and I hate that we don't have some sort of, we wish we could show you a visual of it, but basically within that line, you're going to have areas that bow out, that kind of stick out a little bit farther. That's where those winds are really getting pushed in the backside, and within those bowing segments, at the peak of that, at the apex of that, that's where you're going to have the strongest of the winds. Anytime you see that irregularity in that line, if it kind of jots out or jots in, those are areas of concern because we know something's going on with the wind that causes that irregularity to develop.
And then we've got Sterling Live wanting to know, can you tell us what this storm is most likely to cause? And I think that's what we're covering right now is the destructive wind threat and the amount of wind that's going to come through with the line itself. And any storms that develop out ahead of it going to have a wind threat as well. So this time of the year, most people don't have a whole lot of stuff out in their yards that they need to bring in because it's winter time already. But, if today was trash day, don't forget to bring the trash can in.
Yeah.
You don't want to be going looking for that tomorrow or anything like that.
But
we've also had some weakened trees. We've already
yeah.
had some snow and a little bit of ice, not a terrible amount, but, you know, our trees are a little weak, so we could see some sporadic power outages. They wouldn't last very long, but we could see a few branches come down on power lines kind of thing.
Yeah,
from
yeah,
these
already,
kind of winds.
This afternoon, noticed a couple of small limbs down the driveway at home and pool cover. Not looking too good right now, so
Is it a lost cause?
No, it's not a lost cause, but I'm probably going to have a little something extra to do tomorrow morning.
Okay. Well, if anyone has any more questions, we'll probably wrap up here at 7:45, just to give about 5 more minutes for anyone that has any questions here. The very latest is looking at some live footage just off camera here of what looks like Little Rock, probably where Mike Seidel was from
yeah.
the Weather Channel earlier. He joined us tonight live at 5 o'clock to give a live report there, and they're under tornado warning, so he looks like he's actually taking shelter. Oh, there he is. He's kind of showing the picture there and how strong the winds are.
Our line right now runs from about Farmington through Ironton, Ellington, and Van Buren, Missouri. And so we're talking about for the...
those are not worn, though, right?
Those are not worn, no. This is just kind of our leading edge of this thing. The upper level, mid-level, upper-level energy is still back in Arkansas. Whenever that catches up with our line, that's when we'll see some intensification going on, probably within the next, we'll say, hour and a half or so.
Yeah, by 8, 9 o'clock is
yeah.
when we'll start to see things start to fire up more. We have another question. Where can I get signed up for mobile alerts? There's a couple different ways. If you go to WPSDlocal6.com, up at the top, there is a mobile alert banner, I believe. Looks like a little antenna icon.
Yeah.
And you can sign up for your individual county there. Also, you know, weather calls, another way to get mobile alerts if you want. That is the paid for service, but then again, you're only getting a warning if you're in the direct path of the storm, not
right.
for the entire county. So whichever one suits you better is what you should sign up for, but there are a couple different ways you can do that. Also, do you have any suggestions for those with special needs? Also, same thing with the mobile home theory of planning ahead. You know, make a plan ahead if there's going to be severe weather for the night. Plan to go stay at house or have someone come stay with you so that if you need assistance getting to a safe place.
Yeah.
That's the best way to go about it. If you live in a substantial structure, that's fine. Maybe you have a friend come over and stay with you so that you can
right.
have some assistance in case you lose power, you might need help. That way too.
Yeah, and that's a concern if you have mobility issues, you know. The idea maybe for that night, depending on where your room is located, you know, move to a more interior part of the house as opposed to maybe a room that has a window if you have, you know, that option.
Listen, as a kid, I used to sleep in the bathroom, so there's no shame in if that's where you feel secure and you set up a mm-hmm. little, you know, blow-up mattress or sleeping bag or
yeah.
something. You know, if that's the interior room in your house, you've at least got some more space there.
And
you know, there's no harm in sleeping in the bathroom if there's a serious
yeah.
threat.
And, you know, if you got kids, have fun with it. You know, tell the kids, all right, we're having a camp out. We're going to camp out in the hallway or the closet or, you know,
yeah.
try to make it fun.
It also looks like Steve Jenkins wants to know if we think Marshall County will be in the tornado watch. They're not initially, I don't think.
They are not in this one. I believe it cuts off. It's just, it goes to Graves. It does not include Marshall.
My guess is Storm Prediction Center is probably waiting to see how this energy comes and interacts with the storms off to our west. And I would not be surprised whatsoever if the rest of the area went ahead under tornado watch at
yeah.
some point tonight. But of course, we'll be scrolling that across the screen and be tracking that. We do have team coverage. Kyle, Trent, and myself are all here tonight to make sure that we've got this all covered and getting the best information out. I think that's it for the questions so far. You know, you talked about the kids, and this is one thing that I don't get to talk about too often, but I think kids really are the key to getting the family prepared for severe weather. And I say that because if you give them an active role and like they have a part in your plan, like maybe they decide they're the blanket collector or the to go get the helmets or something so that they feel like they're part of the plan. They, it feels less chaotic to them
yeah.
than when the event actually happens. And so they feel more secure knowing that there is a plan. That's why we encourage families to go ahead and do that together so the kids are less stressed during the event because it's scary. It's scary for kids.
Sure, yeah.
And they just don't comprehend what we can about storms, that most storms don't produce tornadoes.
Yeah.
But, you know, you start hearing the winds and they get scared. But I think if you include them in the family planning, that's the best way to go. And I know that FEMA has a great website for kids, too, that they can learn how to do that. If you just go to FEMA.org or FEMA.gov, there should be a link to kids and preparedness.
Yeah.
And, yes, we do have... this is kind of our own little thing here, and so occasionally you'll see ads running during this. Maybe at some point we'll get this sponsored so that we can purchase the no ad edition of Ustream. This was just our easiest way to communicate with you and have a chat available for viewers to be on that. Kristen saying that she her mom used to pull mattresses off the beds and we would sleep in the hall. I've heard that too, and that's, you know, sometimes that's the most interior place, especially if
yep.
you have a very open floor plan, mm-hmm. and you just have that one hallway that sometimes is the best place to go, so that's
right.
a good idea too.
Right, yeah. Idea being just put as many walls between yourself and the storm as you possibly can. I had had the opportunity to visit with some fourth graders at Franklin Elementary in Metropolis today. And so you can imagine what we spent our time talking about.
Right.
We talked about severe weather. We talked about severe weather safety. And I heard a couple different stories from students. They were talking about, we talked a lot about the May 6th, 2003 tornado over in Massac County. And they had relatives, friends that went through that. And a couple of different stories about how people went to their bathroom, their closet. And that was one of the only parts of the house that was left standing.
It's just amazing. And you know, I'll say over and over again, that is the best place, is an interior bathroom that has one of those bathtub with the fiberglass back
right.
wall on it.
Yeah. The,
it adds just yet another wall between you and the outside
yeah.
to protect you, and it's grounded by plumbing, too, mm-hmm. so it's very secure. It's going to be one of the last things to be damaged by a tornado.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. And, you know, there's a lot of myths with tornado safety. I know one of the things that I heard forever was
windows.
Open your windows
yeah.
so that the air pressure has time to equal out. That is just a total myth. You're wasting your time. If your house is going to get damaged or destroyed by a tornado, it's going to be because of the winds and the flying debris. It's not the
not
pressure.
The, pressure.
The other thing that I always heard was go to the southwest corner of your basement or your house. Well, if you're going to any corner of your house, you're going to be along an exterior wall, which is going to be one of the first to go. And usually the southwest wall is the very first one to go
right.
because this tornado comes from the southwest. So both of those things, I don't know where they got started. That was something that I always heard growing up, and it's just totally wrong.
Yeah. And going back to the window thing too, you're wasting valuable time that you could get to
right.
shelter and you know, minutes are precious, seconds are precious, especially with events like tonight, because they are moving so fast and it can unfold very quickly. Even if there isn't a tornado spotted, one could be developing right near you, and you don't want to waste time opening windows or trying to figure that stuff out. Just get
right.
to the safe place
right.
as fast as possible.
Another myth, we've talked several times about Evansville tonight. That
Rivers.
Tornado crossed the Ohio River
three times
over the course of about 5 minutes.
I love busting that myth just
yeah.
because... Don't think that just because you live along the river that tornadoes are going to skip or not, or, you know,
yeah.
disintegrate. It doesn't happen.
Yeah.
Tornadoes this time of the year, if they're going to go, they're going to go. And they're not going to care about rivers, hills. Erlington's a perfect
mm-hmm.
example of that. That was up on some hilly territory.
Right.
Terrain. And I mean, that was an EF4.
Yeah.
Just wiped out that whole side of that hill
yeah.
over in Erlington. So, don't let that give you a false sense of secure.
Yeah, and
feeling there.
Another thing, the opposite of hills, valleys. People saying, "Oh, if you live in a valley, you're okay. The tornado it'll jump the hill." Well, no, that doesn't happen either. In fact, one of the things, because of physics, if a tornado gets stretched out, sometimes it can actually intensify. So, the whole idea that if you're downhill from a tornado, you're okay. That's just another total complete myth.
Marshall County is another example
yeah.
of that. We're
yeah.
up and down the hills, and it just kept straight on going. We got one more question here. Where do you expect it to be the worst, north or south of the viewing area? The threat right now, the tornado watch does cover all of southern Illinois. I think we're going to have the minimal threat up there. Not to say we're not going to see anything, but I think the further south you go, the greater the threat we're going to see for tornadoes.
Right.
Tennessee, the Boot Hill of Missouri. Further north you go, I think we're going to be talking more about a wind threat, but it all depends on, again, how this energy comes out of Arkansas and interacts with the environment that we've got sitting over us right now, which is very mild, very humid, and we just have to kind of wait to see how this unfolds. And that's why, you know, when we get into an outbreak of severe weather, we just continuous coverage on the air so that we too can follow along and how it unfolds. It's not because we want to interrupt favorite programming. Sometimes it covers up my shows, and I'm not real happy about it either. But
yeah, that's what we're here for. And during instances like this, we're going to stay on top of things. One more. Well, I had a viewer, I guess, listening to our conversations about tornadoes with the hills and the valleys. April 27th, 2011, of course, that was a huge outbreak. An EF4 tornado went up 4,000 feet and back down in the Smoky Mountains.
I want to say that was near Chattanooga.
Yeah.
And I think that was when weather radios spiked out there.
Yeah.
Was because of that one.
Right.
Would you ever think of EF4 in the Smoky Mountains?
No.
No. But it can happen anywhere. That's the thing. And we're talking about pretty extreme weather and climate here in this area. Anything can happen. I'm convinced that, you know, crazy weather does happen here all the time. And that's why we stress preparedness so much. There was one other question. Any other weather myths that we can dispel?
Let's
see. The rivers.
Okay.
Not concerning tornadoes.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. How many times, and I'm from here. I've heard this for,
decades.
Long time. Yeah, I don't want to date myself too much.
Decades.
But you know, you got to think about the fact that the Ohio and Mississippi rivers, I don't know exactly how wide, you know, quarter, half mile wide, something like that. You're talking about large-scale weather systems that span thousands of miles. This particular system that we're dealing with right now runs from the Great Lakes all the way down through the Deep South, and so a quarter or half mile wide river is not going to do anything at all as far as dissipating a large-scale storm system. Are there minor scale variations in our weather that we could see because of the rivers? In certain instances, yes. I know, fog definitely is something that the river does affect. But as far as, our event tonight, a tornado, we've seen multiple instances where tornadoes have crossed the river. Being from Massac County, I've seen a number of times that tornadoes start in Ballard County, go across the river into Massac County. So,
I think we have an addition to the watch.
Yeah.
Northwest Tennessee went ahead and added their counties, Gibson, Dyer, Lake, Weakley, Obion. And that's it, I think, for our area.
Yeah.
But it looks like all the way down to Memphis.
Looks like basically
Jackson, Memphis, maybe.
Don't believe Jackson's in that. Not seeing Madison County in there. But it looks like basically outside of our area, Crockett County is pretty close to us. Lauderdale.
It looks like probably
Shelby.
Henry and Carroll.
Henry and Carroll
are the
not.
Only two,
yeah,
as well as
our,
Stewart. Stewart's not involved either.
Yeah.
But again, that might be added later. So we've got almost the entire Local 6 area under this tornado watch now. Does that go to 1 a.m. also?
Yes.
Okay. Till 1 a.m. And then Tammy wants to know, what is the likelihood of Graves getting a tornado? Well, we're in the tornado watch. The environment is going to be favorable for that. We want to stress that while we could see some isolated tornadoes tonight, our biggest threat is damaging winds. And we're talking about winds that could be just as destructive as a very weak tornado.
Right.
So that's the big concern tonight. Just making sure that even if you're under a severe thunderstorm warning at some point, you're taking it seriously, because we may be warning on very strong winds and not necessarily a tornado.
Right. And I wish we could forecast tornadoes
pinpoint, I know.
You know, hours, days ahead of time. That's just not possible right now. That's why we take the time to play these events up so that you're weather aware and paying attention that way. Whenever we do have that indication of rotation or something going on the next county over, then the warning comes out. And your role in this is to be ready to receive those warnings if and when a warning is issued for Graves or any other county.
Okay, and I'm going to give it one more minute. I know we were going to go off at 7:45, but might as well take it till 8 o'clock. So five more minutes. That we can take some questions just to get in here, because I know there are a lot of you actually watching right now, and we want to make sure that you're feeling secure about the knowledge that you have for tonight's storms.
One more weather myth that we talked about today during my school visit was the idea of what do you do if you're driving and there's a tornado. The one myth that back in the 90s, because of a certain storm chaser, was very popular. There was a big video that came out of the storm chaser taking cover under an overpass. They climbed up into the little corner there and rode the storm out. That was well documented and well played out on TV. It was a terrible idea because of the shape of that. You have the kind of the angle there. You get up in that area, it generates a wind tunnel effect. So the winds are actually blowing faster, and you have absolutely no protection from flying debris.
Yeah, and barely anything to hang on to. I mean,
yeah.
People were crowded up in there, and they could just be blown out. And that
yeah.
has happened.
Right.
Unfortunately, people have died that way. They just don't show when that happens.
Right.
They always replay the ones where people made
right.
it out safely. So, you know, if you're in the path of a storm, tornadic storm, don't drive up to the underpass.
No.
Drive to somewhere where you can either seek more substantial shelter or the ditch theory. Back to that
yeah.
again. That's your best bet. And try to drive at right angles. If you can figure that out, a lot of people may not be able to do that, but if you drive at right angles away from the storm,
yeah.
that is also the best way. Most storms move southwest to northeast.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you're driving right angles away from it, that would typically get you away from the storm.
Yeah.
So
most do, but tornadoes mm-hmm. are very unpredictable. So best thing to do, get in the ditch, go to a more substantial building and play it safe.
Okay. Well, I think we're going to wrap this up here. I don't see any more questions, but we will be on. Kyle Mounts will be doing Local 6 at 9 o'clock coming up here in about an hour. He will have the very latest on that. That is on our digital signal.
Yeah, 6.2 and 6.3 Antenna TV.
Yes, and we will also be streaming live weather, not here on Ustream, but on our web channel, WPSDLocal6.com.
Yep.
We'll be streaming live any severe weather coverage there in the case or in the event that you lose satellite or cable, which often happens around here to
yeah.
everybody, even us here at the station. But we'll continue to simulcast if we have severe weather during the 9. Kyle will be cutting in for Local 6 on the WPSD site as well.
Right.
So, and then I'll join him at 10 o'clock then, and we'll have the very latest. And of course, we always feel it's important to be here throughout the duration. So
yeah.
We'll have team coverage throughout the rest of the night until the storms are officially out of the area.
Maybe a long night, but we're in it for the duration. Hopefully we can get rid of this thing. And starting tomorrow, it's back to winter.
It's back to winter. We got some cold temperatures headed our way. I just put a 30-degree reading for a high on Friday, which does not please me at all.
No,
but
no.
Again, but extreme weather and climate.
We are just over 2 weeks away from pitchers and catchers reporting for spring training. So
he's ready
that
for
makes
football,
me happy.
And I'm just ready for spring because I like the season of life. I like to see leaves on the trees and blooming bulbs, which unfortunately are already happening right now because it's been so warm. The dockles and the daffodils.
I had a daffodil in bloom in mid-December, and I have hyacinths in bloom currently in the backyard.
They smell good.
They do smell good. You have to get down to the dirt on your knees to smell them.
You might have a little snow on them sometime in the near future.
I went out for a run today, and on Jefferson Street, Paducah, saw two bushes that were in the spring.
That's crazy.
Spring blooms are coming out. So
we breed extreme.
It's out there.
All right, we're going to sign off here, and thanks to all of you that watched. I noticed a lot of you commenting on there, and thank you for being part of the webisode that we're doing tonight. We're going to try and do this a little more often, especially when we've got severe weather, but also when we've got extreme climate as well. And we talk about extreme climate changes. We hope to be doing more of this as well. So we'll leave you with that. And just my saying of community prepared is a community strong. And that's what we want to promote here. And hopefully this has helped you do that.
All right.
Good night.